some of Jimmy Buffett's greatest songs throughout the game. Make sure to stop by the concession stand during the game. One lucky fan will win a cheeseburger in paradise prize. And tonight only, get your Kick League tie-dye t-shirts on sale for only $15. At this time, we ask you to please rise for the singing of the National Anthem. Here to perform tonight's National Anthem, please welcome Steve Ruiz.
Yeah!
Steve is a well-known American guy. He is the executive director of WCTV and sings at most town meetings. Steve also has a background in gospel music. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Steve Ruiz.
Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, o'er the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming, and the rocket's red glare, the bombs bursting in air, it proved through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say does that star-spangled banner yet wave o'er the land of the free and the home of the
this evening is Patrick Peters. Patrick is a Game and Bat kid, and his family also hosts Game and Players. He is 13 and plays Babe Ruth baseball. Oh, when you're in, Patrick, let's see a pitch. Here to tonight, say those two famous words we've all been waiting to hear. We have tonight's back kids, Sophia Irish and Daniel Peters.
Play ball!
Back kids for this evening are Sophia Irish and Daniel Peters. Official score, Matthew Fell.
You're watching Wareham Gateman Baseball on WCTV. Welcome into today's broadcast. I'm Connor Federico, joined by Matthew Weasel Thayer and our whole WCTV crew tonight. It's a great night for baseball here at Spillane Field. And the Wareham Gateman, they start this game in the field. It'll be John Topa in left, Stephen Kwan in center, Tristan Pompey in right. Across the infield, Robbie Metz at third, Kyle Kasser, the shortstop, Jaron Duran at second, Jake Anchia at first. Willie McIver will do the catching tonight for tonight's starting pitcher, Miller Hogan, the righty out of the University of St. Louis.
Really quick, before we get to Miller Hogan, we got to talk about that Star Spangled Banner really quick. That was probably the best one we've heard here so far.
Easily.
Steve from WCTV, I'll tell you what, we've hung out with him a bunch. I was not expecting that voice to come out of him. Man. And if Miller Hogan's able to pitch the way that that Star Spangled Banner was sung today, he's giving it a good spot, and he's been able to do that his past couple starts. He's gotten 10 straight innings with no runs allowed, 6 strikeouts in both of his last 2 starts. He's been phenomenal for the Gateman, and you have to expect then later his partner, basically in crime, in the past 2 games has been 3 innings from Tanner Dodson, who's been phenomenal. So we expect to see him later in the game, a pitching duo that's been great for the Gateman, who need a great start and a great finish for them, their entire pitching staff.
Miller Hogan is a guy who can give you 5 solid innings, a 2-0 record on the summer, a 2.08 ERA, very impressive stats for Hogan. And last night, we saw a pitcher for the Gateman go 6 innings for the first time, and it was Griffin Roberts. Sort of unexpected.
Unexpected, and I'm not going to expect it again tonight. One of the reasons is because Tanner Dodson is back there ready to pitch today. He's scheduled to pitch. He can give you a few long innings. The Gateman were coming off 2 straight extra inning games, didn't have a lot of pitching depth left. Now they do, and now they're going to be in a good spot.
Well, the first batter tonight for the Brewster Whitecaps, it's a guy who will know the catcher, Willie McIver, pretty well from their spring at the University of Washington. It's A.J. Graffanino, and he'll lead off. The lefty who sometimes switch hits, he did for a long time in high school, but he will bat on the left side either way against Miller Hogan. Sends this first pitch up in the air towards Kwan in center. He is under it, and just like last night, starting pitcher for the Gateman gets 1 pitch and 1 out.
And that's always a great sign to see if you're a pitcher to get, hey, you got into the groove really quickly. Well, if you get that first out, it's always nice to see it. And we see this a lot with the relief pitchers so far for the Gateman, coming in bad situations and then giving up a first batter hit, and that's been throwing them off their entire appearance. So getting the first out quick, always good for your confidence moving forward.
Here's a guy that's going to be a little more difficult to retire. It's Chandler Taylor, one of 5 Cape Cod baseball leaguers to participate in the College Home Run Derby at Omaha just at the start of this month, July 1st. And he's one of 2 Brewster players who were on the College Home Run Derby roster. He finished in second. He lost by 1. He was actually at the plate for one of those bonus balls that means double. He had one out left, and he ended up swinging and hitting a ground ball. So one swing meant everything for him. He was either going to win it or lose it, and he ended up coming in second.
Yeah, and that home run derby was a great home run derby to watch. Oh, yeah. Tristan Pompey of the Gateman, who you'll see batting 5th for the Gateman tonight, he was in it, and he had a phenomenal first round. But for Taylor, it really was, he got into such a groove at the end of his round with about a minute left. He had about 6 or 7 home runs. He was in such a groove. Really nice to see. And then when you get in that groove, you want to just hit the next pitch. And for him, he hit the next pitch. It wasn't the best pitch thrown to him. And that'll do it in a home run derby.
Did you enjoy that home run derby, the College Home Run Derby, or last night's Major League Home Run Derby more?
I'm going to say last night's Home Run Derby not last night's Home Run Derby. The College Home Run Derby. And the reason is last night, when we saw it, we didn't really have to watch too hard because Aaron Judge literally walked in and just dominated the entire thing.
There's no parody.
No parody. You know, it's like we were looking, you know, it's like we're watching the NBA right now. The Western Conference is so much better than the Eastern Conference. You know, I like to see parody. I like to see everyone have a good shot coming out, and we saw that in the College World Series Home Run Derby.
For sure. All right, so Chandler Taylor just struck out for strikeout of the night for Miller Hogan. The new batter, Mickey Gasper, one of 3 catchers on this Brewster Whitecaps team. He's a Bryant Bulldog, but fun fact about all the Brewster catchers, one goes to Gardner-Webb, one goes to Georgia, Gasper goes to Bryant. They're all Bulldogs back at school.
Yeah, it must be really, you know, it must be kind of confusing. You know, everyone's like, oh, you know, we need the Bulldog catcher. Well, that's not going to come in today. But, you know, it's a little, it's always nice to see that other teams are utilizing that three catcher system because it shows how important the catcher is in this game.
Jasper is a true switch hitter, batting from the left side and fouling this one off. Miller Hogan, he's had an impressive start so far.
And this has been his past few games, really, especially the first inning, hasn't dealt with a lot of issues, whereas a couple other pitchers for the game, and particularly, in my mind, Joey Matulovich, his first inning of work, he's gotten into a little bit of trouble, and it's really been how he's coming in the second inning and determined the rest of it. For Miller Hogan, it's just been straight dominance through his five innings.
He's got a 1-2 count here. Pitch is just called outside, according to home plate umpire tonight, Sparky Burns. At first, it's Steven Williams, and at third, it's Ronaldo Cockrum. Some of the best umpire names in the Cape Cod Baseball League are with us tonight. Sparky. Sparky behind the plate. We'll have a 2-2 pitch to call here, and he says low.
And the man at the bat, Michael Gasper, for the Brewster Whitecaps, they've had a little bit of issues the past few games getting some hitting, and Gasper's been one of the better hitters the past four games, hitting .400.
He keeps this at-bat alive right now with a 3-2 pitch, rather, fouled away. So he was down 1-2 in this count, has now found a way to get a full count.
It's really important.
Wait on the payoff pitch.
It's really important, just, and you've seen this a few times, that if you're not able to work the count in this league, you're going to run into a lot of trouble.
So the 3-2 from 3-3 in white. Hogan deals, swinging, foul ball. One got by the first baseman, Anchia, who we've seen mostly at catcher this season. This is his second start of the summer at first base. He definitely is a great defensive catcher, can pick balls out of the dirt, but he doesn't provide you the same sort of height that Blake Sable showed off yesterday at first.
Yeah, and the other thing that you don't get with Anchia, obviously you have McIver back there who has a phenomenal arm, but Anchia might have the best arm on this team getting people picked off at first base.
And speaking of first base, that's where Mickey Gasper will head right now after walking on that 3-2 pitch. So a long at-bat for Miller Hogan, he ends up giving away his first base runner of this game.
And that's something you don't want to see if you're the Gaiman, who have run into a little bit of issues with walks as of recent. And his last two starts, Miller Hogan didn't have any walks. That's a little bit of a scary thing if you're the Gaiman. You don't want to see him start throwing balls like the other pitchers have.
So here is Michael Curry, the Georgia Bulldog. He'll be the DH tonight. Takes a pitch outside from Hogan. Runner on first is Gasper, who just walked. So Bulldog follows Bulldog, like we talked about. First team All-SEC selection this year for Curry. Really impressive in that loaded Southeastern Conference. Man, we can hear that strike call from Sparky Burns all the way out here in left field.
He's living up to his name right now. Sparky is definitely Sparky out there. And that's definitely nice to see. You always like to see the umpires really get into the game as well.
Oh, yeah. Pickoff move from Miller Hogan. Yeah, we talked about Curry being first team All-SEC, hit .297 this year for the Bulldogs, 10 home runs, 46 RBIs. Georgia did not have the strongest season by their standards. Line drive, this one is just going to get over the head of Duran. Gasper thinks about heading for third but holds up. It's going to be a two-out single, and these are where the problems have been coming for the Gateman. You get the first two outs, and then suddenly the situation changes a couple batters later.
And it's just been wrapping up innings, and it seems so simple. You have two outs. Things are getting better. All you got to do is get that last out of the inning, and this is where Gateman pitchers have struggled the past few nights. And you know, this is where this is going to make the difference when it comes to the end of the season, especially with run differential being one of the big stats. A run right here. If this end turns up to a blowout, and maybe you got one run here or something like that, could be one run makes a difference. You need to be able to retire the side. Get that last out of the inning.
So Miller Hogan working out of the stretch. He's got a runner on second. Gasper, who walked, runner on first, who had a single. Soft ground ball to the first baseman, Anchia. He flips it to Miller Hogan, and that will do the top of the first inning. So the Gatemen, they give up a runner in scoring position, but nobody comes across. At the end of a half inning, this score is still 0-0. You're watching Wareham Gateman Baseball on WCTV.
Our corporate sponsors are the financial backbone of the league. And through the banner support that we are
Well, the Gateman, they come into this game 10-13-1. You're watching Wareham Gateman Baseball on WCTV. Connor Federico, Matthew Wieselt there, the entire WCTV crew tonight. And the WCTV ringleader Steve just sang a great national anthem, and we appreciate him for that. Starting lineup tonight for the Gateman, Stephen Kwan, he'll bat first and play center field. Kyle Kasher, he'll bat second, followed by Willie McIver. John Topa tonight in the four spot. We'll get to that a little later. Tristan Pompey, he'll bat fifth and for the first time is playing right field. Jake Antia will play first and bat sixth. Luke Bonfield, tonight's DH, bats seventh. Jaron Duran, the second baseman, bats eighth. And rounding out the lineup, wearing number nine and batting nine, is Robbie Metz. But here is Stephen Kwan.
It is absolutely crucial that the Gateman get at least two runs in the first three innings. We've seen this a few times that they haven't been able to do that, and it's cost them dearly the past couple games.
As always, Stephen Kwan, he shows bunt on the very first pitch of the game. It draws the third baseman in, but we usually don't see him end up bunting after he shows on that first pitch.
You know, just trying to force the defense to play the way you want them to, not the way that they want to.
Kwan, ground ball, and that'll be strike two. Joe Mulleteer is the pitcher tonight for the Brewster Whitecaps. Comes out of Monmouth University in New Jersey. Struggled a bit in the spring. Was mostly a reliever, but he'll start here tonight for the Brewster Whitecaps. And deals a ball low to Stephen Kwan, who coming into this game batting over 500 through a week of games with the Gateman.
Problem right now for the Gateman is, you know, besides him, everyone else is kind of taking a step back, and that's a huge issue.
Now the count will go full. I apologize. Kwan is not batting over 500, but he has been for the first couple of games. He comes into this game with a .444 batting average through seven appearances with the Gateman. He hasn't had an off day since he arrived.
Yeah, but he has had a couple off days in his performance, and especially the last couple days, and it's been all the Gateman that have struggled. And I don't want to say this is a must-win game for the Gateman, but three straight non-winning performances, it's gonna really take a toll on your team.
Sparky Burns punches out Stephen Kwan, and that'll be strike three. Tough at bat for Kwan. He thought that one missed the outside corner,
and that's tough for so many reasons. Because you really want to get something started, and it's tough to do that when your leadoff hitter isn't able to get on. And this really, the reason it's such a must-win game, not only is it the performances, but the last two games, they have three runs, and one of those came when they were getting no hit. So you need the you need the hitting to start coming alive. That's the reason John Topa is in that four spot, because, you know, the All-Star game's coming up. Potential All-Stars, John Topa might be one of them.
Ground ball. And Kyle Kasher is retired on his very first swing. We haven't seen Kasher a lot in that two spot, but that's where he bats tonight, and he will now get sent back to the dugout.
Yeah, that's usually where Tanner Dodson's been batting, but Dodson, they're planning on pitching him today, so they're not going to plan on just having him do, they want him to do just one, not the other. That's generally been what Dodson's been doing, a couple times designated hitting and then going to pitch, but mainly they want him to focus on one or the other on a particular day.
Mulleteer out of the windup misses to Willie McIver, who he did have that off day yesterday. Hopes that it helps him out a little bit. I mean, he came into yesterday starting every single game for the Gateman.
And that could be exhausting for any player, especially you're dealing with the two extra innings games. So you needed an off day. You know, if you're a catcher particularly, you're going to catch. Your legs need to get rest. It's the reason why you see catchers all the time in extra inning games. You have to sub one out, is because it takes so much of a toll on you to have your catcher be catching every single inning. It takes so much to do that. Brain power, not only besides the physical toll, to be able to do all that, that's why you need your catcher rested, and that's why McIver was out yesterday.
He is behind the plate tonight, but first at the dish with the 2-1. Big swing and a miss, strike two. And that's what we've seen a lot from the Gateman recently, trying to break slumps by taking big swings. That might be the opposite approach that Coach Don Sneddon wants them to have.
Yeah, Don Sneddon's been preaching the small ball technique all season long, but when you're trying to swing for the fences every single day, it's going to cause a lot of problems. We saw that a lot from Tristan Pompey, who's now gotten a little more into the grounders that have gotten into hits, and that's going to make you a lot better players if you're able to just get hits, get on base, get the next runner on. The home runs will come, but most importantly is not getting out.
Willie McIver is the only thing standing between a 1-2-3 inning for Joe Mulleteer, number 29 in that sort of teal blue that the Whitecaps wear on the road. And he misses, so McIver will walk. So we see early walks given up by each of these pitchers.
And that's what you want to see if you're the Gateman, is really seeing the ball a lot better. They were doing that this past week, and then this week they've been struggling a little more with that, trying to really... Sometimes when you get in a groove, you see a couple guys hit home runs, you want to start hitting the long ball. And for this team, you got to realize that it's tough to realize sometimes to not change your swing at all. You got a nice home run. Congrats. Get back to the swing that you had. Get back and don't try to just get it over the fence every time, because that's not going to win you games.
So here's John Topa for the first time in his collegiate career, either with his college team or in the summer, hitting in the four hole. Talking to him today, he really is only used to the one and two spots in the lineup at UConn. The Gatemen have used him anywhere from 5 to 9 in the lineup, mostly at the 6th spot or the 8th spot. That's where he's really shined. Tonight he's going to get an even number again, but it's his first time in the cleanup role.
And this really is more of a move to kind of push Willie McIver to second and get John Topa on. You'll have two runners on for your next guy, and you bring in two power hitters right after that with Tristan Pompey and Jake Anchia. Those are the guys that are going to be your cleanup hitters, really, in a sense. Whereas John Topa's role is to just keep moving along, keep the rowing the boat, as one would say, maybe, you know? Just keep everything going, and that way you can get the next duck on the pond.
And now Topa will have a 3-0 count, so 5 consecutive balls thrown by Moltier. And now his catcher, Gasper, wants to talk to him.
Have to wonder how long they plan on pitching Moltier. His last outing was one inning. He gave up 2 hits and an earned run. So it's going to be interesting to see how Moltier responds to a starting role this time.
Well, the story for the Brewster Whitecaps is they've lost a lot of starting pitching recently. They've been trying to add guys, but a lot of guys have gone home due to innings limits or just calling it quits for the summer. And John Topa sucked in his gut there, but he'll get the first called strike.
And that's why a strategy like Jim Lawler's is so respected, because that 65-pitch mark, which is so important, is really allowing these pitchers to preserve themselves. And you're seeing a few of these pitchers that are starting right now that might have to leave in a little bit, but they might have had to leave earlier.
Ground ball, base hit for John Topa. So the Gatemen, they have a walk and a hit with 2 outs. This inning is going nearly identically that it did to the top of the first for Brewster.
And the question is right now is if the batter that's coming up can keep moving the runners along. And that's Tristan Pompey, who last night was able to do that quite effectively. And he was one of the few hitters for the game and that was able to be effective.
Pompey had 2 hits to the right side yesterday. Just like you talked about, ground balls that he hit hard and could find a hole. And he's a switch hitter batting on the left side against Moltier.
Don Sneddon was mentioning that, you know, when Tristan Pompey went to the home run derby, that it might affect his swing a little bit. And it's taken him a little bit to get back into that, but now he's able to use his speed a little more.
Both teams have 1 hit through the first inning so far. But coming into this game, Matt, Brewster in their last 10 are hitting .231. And in Wareham's last 10, they're hitting .283. However, Brewster's had the better record.
You know, it just shows that a lot of this is winning close games, which, you know, it just shows that you don't have to get all the hits all the time if your pitching backs you up. And for the Gatemen, it seems like the runs will come in spurts. You know, they'll score 9 runs in one game, and the next game they're not scoring any. And they have had a lot of issues with these close game situations.
Pompey, ground ball straight to the first baseman, and Infante steps on the bag. And that will do it. So the Gatemen, 2 outs, get a walk and a base hit. But that will be it. After 1, the score is 0-0. You're watching Gatemen Baseball on WCTV. Top of the second here at Clem Spillane Field in Wareham, Massachusetts. A nice sunset glow coming over Spillane Field right now. Connor Federico, Matthew Weasel Thayer, and the WCTV crew along with you for this one. Miller Hogan's first pitch of the second, cut on and missed by Hunter Bishop from Arizona State.
Yeah, nice to see the weather clearing up earlier in the day, raining a little bit. Chances of thunderstorms at 4 o'clock never came in. Now it's just a nice, peaceful day. A little humid out, but not nearly as bad as we've seen in certain days.
Miller Hogan forces an 0-2 count early. Big swing and a miss there from Bishop, who the Pac-12, you know, they don't have the normal sort of first team, second team, third team award setup. There's the All-Pac-12 team, and then there's the All-Pac-12 honorable mention team. They don't even have an all-freshman team like most conferences do. Hunter Bishop hit 301 in his freshman year just this spring with the Sun Devils. Made the honorable mention team, but he's punched out right here. Called strike three.
You know, I'm not always a fan of looking for things outside of the game that might not be important, but man, do I love Sparky strikeout call. It reminds me a little bit of Jim Joyce, an MLB umpire, who you could hear him call strikes from 400 feet away, and you know it's him.
Yeah. So that is the third strikeout of the night overall, but only Miller Hogan's second. First looking. Pop up towards the Brewster dugout. Robbie Metz and McIver giving chase. Metz reaches over, makes the catch in the Brewster dugout. Two away.
And the Brewster broadcasters are right above the Brewster dugout. They were looking for a souvenir right there, and they were a little disappointed.
Well, we did see Tristan Pompey throw a bat into that little Brewster, not the away broadcaster enclosure over there just a couple of weeks ago. Were those the Bourne guys? I forget.
It was either Bourne or Falmouth.
Oh, it was Falmouth, I think.
And I can tell you, they all looked at each other. It was one of the most interesting things I've ever seen. You know, because you've seen bats go into the stands before, but not really ever do you see them go to the broadcasters. They're calling the game at the same time.
So you'd expect your biggest power hitters hitting the 3-4-5 spot. Not for Brewster. Here's another guy, Julian Infante, who was a college home run derby participant. He is in the 8 spot tonight for Brewster, and we talked about Chandler Taylor already. He's in the 2 spot tonight. So Brewster also doing some interesting lineup things. In the College Home Run Derby in Omaha, Infante came in third place. He hit 29 total home runs, just above the Gateman's Tristan Pompey, who had 27 total.
When I was talking to a scout from the Boston Red Sox, all he said about Infante was pure, raw power. And this is someone that clearly can easily hit it over the fences here at Spillane Field, which is a very deep park.
Well, we weren't expecting to see any home runs last night from the Chatham game, but Shea Langeliers, the three-hitter, it seemed almost like a pop-up that just never ended up falling down until it was over Stephen Kwan's head in center.
It was crushed off the bat, and yet never felt like it was going to go over the fence. Yeah. Stephen Kwan was running and running, and there's no warning track here at Spillane Field except for right field, and he just ran into the wall and ran out of room.
Well, I mean, when with a park as deep as this, and you got to think right now, Kwan in center is about 50 feet away from the wall that reads 412 feet. Maybe he's more like 60 or 70 feet away. I mean, you just sort of run until you hit something, I guess.
Yeah, you run and pray that you have enough time to get to the ball, and the unfortunate thing is that home run really was where things started unwinding for the Gateman.
Line drive goes over Robbie Metz's glove and falls in for a fair ball. Topa picks it up. Can he gun down the runner at second? Yes, he does! John Topa erases a double for Julian Infante, and that will end the top of the second inning. No runs, one hit, and no errors. No men left on base after the double. We'll go to the bottom of the second. Can the Gateman get it going? Find out on WCTV. So the top of the second ends in a gunning down of Julian Infante by the left fielder John Topa. And the bottom of the second will start off with Jake Antia for the Gateman. Antia, Bonfield, and Duran. 6-7-8 part of this order is due up for the Gateman.
We mentioned pure power from Infante, and Jake Antia has that already two home runs here in Spillane Field. Excuse me, three home runs in Spillane Field.
Yeah, really impressive power for the right-handed Division II hitter, Jake Antia, out of Nova Southeastern University. And, the D2 guys have really stepped it up for the Gateman. You don't often expect that. And so far, Justin Montgomery, Jake Antia, they've been showing off as guys who the Gateman can really rely on.
And one guy also who's come in very recently, who's probably the most impressive to me, is Dalton Roach, the D2 pitcher of the year.
Oh, right. Forgot about him.
Absolutely electric stuff, basically closing for the Gateman so far this season.
Righty on righty matchup here. And Anchia fouls this one off his upper body. So we'll get an 0-2. That one looking dangerously close to Anchia's face.
And Chia, usually when those balls are hit into the ground, he's usually behind the plate catching them, not used to having them bounce right back on him and having no padding on him.
So Anchia in an 0-2 hole here. Molitaire deals, and this one's popped up. Molitaire can go with either a changeup or a slider. Has no really big breaking ball, though. The slider is sort of close to Molitaire's two-seam fastball and four-seam fastball speed, around the low 90s. Now out of the windup, Antia still has to deal with this 0-2 pitch. Swing and miss, strike three. Antia down on strikes, and both... So far, the start of both of these innings have been very similar. And the first two batters in the first inning, Graffino and Taylor for Brewster and Kwan and Kasser for Wareham, one struck out and the other was retired. Then a walk by the three hitters, a base hit by the four hitters, and a ground out to the first baseman for the five hitters. Both of, in this second inning, both six hitters struck out, and if the trend were to say the same, Luke Bonfield would hit a pop-up in foul territory. Luke Bonfield here, out of the University of Arkansas, has had a good summer with the Gateman, a late addition to the team. He played two games with the Gateman back in 2016 and takes called strike two. So now Bonfield in a hole as well. Last summer, in those two games, Bonfield hit 3-for-8, good for a .375 batting average, and had an RBI. And Molitaire's 1-2. Bonfield tries to hold up, but he can't. Strike three. Molitaire dealing early. So Jaron Duran, he'll bat now, trying to prevent this from being a 1-2-3 inning. Duran, the lefty, facing Molitaire, the righty. Duran hitting .226 coming into this game. Shows bunt, pulls it back, but takes called strike one anyway. This is Duran's 16th game as a member of the Gateman. Has two triples, four RBIs. Interesting enough, Duran has no doubles, but those two triples right in between the extra base hit categories. And he takes ball one on the outside. Molitaire has really been working ahead in the count early. And on deck is Robbie Metz. And then the order will flip for the Gateman if they can get to that point here in the second. And Duran fouls this one off towards the Gateman dugout. Duran out of Long Beach State, where he had a very good season for the Dirtbags. Hit .308, had 27 RBIs, 19 stolen bases. He can really show off with his legs. But he strikes out and he won't get to. Joe Molitaire strikes out the side, all swinging. Anchia, Bonfield, and Duran go down. That ends the second. You're watching WCTV, Wareham, Gateman Baseball. Top of the third here, it'll be Nick Dunn, the nine batter, leading it off for the Brewster Whitecaps in this 0-0 game. Miller Hogan's been great, but so has Joe Molitaire for the Brewster Whitecaps. He just struck out the side.
And that's something you love to see as a pitcher's duel here in the Cape. And when you talk to Don Sneddon and we ask him, hey, you know, the hitting's been struggling a little bit. What's up? He said, the pitching is just so good here in the Cape, and that's one reason why you just saw in that last inning.
Here's a pop-up to the shallow outfield. The shortstop Casser's under it. He'll call for it and make the play.
You know, it's always interesting watching shortstops run back and make those plays. Generally, they don't have as great an eye on fly balls as outfielders do. So, you know, outfielders are dealing with them all the time with fly balls, deep fly balls. And generally, the center fielder will call off the shortstop in that case. Instead, Kwan lets Casser take it, and Casser had to take just a couple steps back right before and was able to make the play.
So here's the top of the lineup for A.J. Graffanino. Miller Hogan retired him in one pitch his last time up, and his first pitch here is a strike. A.J.'s father is Tony Graffanino, who played in the majors for 13 years. Between 1997 and 2009, he was a second baseman for the Atlanta Braves, Tampa Bay Devil Rays at the time, Chicago White Sox, Kansas City Royals, Boston Red Sox, Milwaukee Brewers, and Cleveland Indians. That's a very long list.
Very long list, and it's always, you know, it's one of the more important people is the journeymen, are people that you know you can bring in and gets results.
Here's a pop-up to Anchia in foul territory, and the first baseman makes the play. Always nice to see catchers make great athletic plays like that, running behind them and putting away the batter.
And that's especially nice, especially after last night where Jake Anchia was trying to make a play on a ball, lost it a little bit in the lights. Blake Sable then comes over to try and call him off and make a play, and instead it was a base hit and costly for the Gateman in a situation where every hit matters, especially when you're only going to score two runs in a game.
Chandler Taylor's back up now to face Miller Hogan. Only thing between Hogan and a 1-2-3 inning. Just happens to be an all-SEC freshman teamer just a spring ago. He'll be a junior next year at the University of Alabama, but two seasons ago had 9 home runs and 33 RBIs. That upgraded to 16 home runs and 34 RBIs his sophomore year.
Always nice to see the power that these batters can bring, and you know, you might see that in a few weeks he could be one of the players that we see in this home run derby at Spillane Field.
Taylor upgraded everything from his freshman to sophomore season, which would make sense on the surface, but we don't see it very often just because when guys have breakout freshman years, it turns out teams scout them a little more, they become more prepared for them. It's tougher their sophomore years, the sophomore slump is a famous saying throughout all sorts of sports. He rips one. This is going to be a base hit in the right field. Pompey's first action out and right, just picking up a ground ball and throwing it in. So a two-out base hit for Chandler Taylor. Here comes Mickey Gasper, who had a walk his last time up. The switch hitter will be a senior for the Bryant Bulldogs next spring. Taylor on first. He has some speed, had 7 stolen bases in both his freshman and sophomore seasons at Alabama. And Hogan will have to work out of the stretch for the first time this inning. Miller Hogan from the University of St. Louis had 15 starts this year for the Billikens, a 2.70 ERA, 8-3 record, 78 strikeouts, good enough to make the All-Atlantic 10 second team. He's been really good for the Gateman.
He's been arguably their best pitcher. Obviously, Justin Montgomery has a 0.00 ERA, but Miller Hogan's gone in and just been dominant, strikeout after strikeout all the time, every time he goes out. And it's also really nice when you have Tanner Dodson right behind you, who's one of the best relief pitchers that the Gatemen have, one of the best players they have right now overall, and being able to do it in the field, at the plate, and of course on the mound. So it's really nice to have that tandem going.
Dodson, in both of Miller Hogan's wins, Tanner Dodson was the second guy, was the first guy to come out of the bullpen in replacing him. Ground ball, foul, 2 strikes.
Both cases pitched 3 innings. One of them gave up a couple runs, but also in both those games, Miller Hogan got a ton of run support.
Yeah.
And that's something that he doesn't have now, which is, a lot to say, seeing how the run support came in the first and second innings by the Gateman the last two times he's gone out to the mound. So that's, you know, not getting seven runs on the board very early definitely makes your life a tiny bit more stressful, but that's what you expect from your pitcher to be able to handle that.
Pickoff throw will not beat the runner, Taylor. Two outs, and the runner on first is Chandler Taylor. At the plate, it's Mickey Gasper out of Bryant. On deck, the cleanup hitter, Michael Curry, who's one of two Whitecaps with a single today. Miller Hogan sort of worried over there about Chandler Taylor at first, but you know, another part of picking guys off at Spillane is the field surface. It can definitely wear an opposing player out. And now Taylor's picked off. Caster's tag, got him. That will do the top of the third inning. No runs, no hits, one hit, no errors, and no men left on base after the pickoff. We'll go to the bottom of the third. The Gatemen need to get Miller Hogan some run support. Well, during that little break, you heard Jimmy Buffett coming out of the speakers here at Spillane Field. It is Jimmy Buffett night here at Spillane. I think one lucky fan is going to win some sort of cheeseburger in paradise.
I'm sadly not one of those fans, but I would definitely go for one of those cheeseburgers in paradise right about now.
We haven't heard Lawrence, the man in charge of the music up in the press box, play any the Cheeseburger in Paradise song yet, but that last song, Finn's favorite of mine. So up here, Robbie Metz, returning Gateman, West All-Star last season. Takes a ball outside. After Metz, it'll be Kwan and Kasser, so the order will flip. Kwan and Kasser both 0-for-1 today. Kwan struck out looking to lead off the bottom of the first. Metz slaps one out to right field, and Taylor is right there to make the play. One down.
Important for the Gaben to get a runner on with more than less than two outs on the board. They've had a lot of issues with that the past few nights, and the one time they were able to really do that successfully was against, actually in the game against, it was two nights ago, where they were able to be successful against YD, but it was just because they got a runner on first with a walk.
So Stephen Kwan takes his first pitch for a ball.
Obviously, Stephen Kwan, someone who, if he gets on first, you know, a walk right now, you can almost look at it as a double because of how fast he is.
Stephen Kwan, this spring with Oregon State, they made it all the way to the College World Series, just fell a game short of making the College World Series finals. Instead, it was LSU who took their spot and lost to Florida. But this spring had a .440 on base percentage to pair up with his .331 batting average. He just knows how to get himself on.
And obviously, when you're the leadoff hitter for the best team in the country in the regular season, you're doing something right. And Stephen Kwan, he's brought it here a couple times, hasn't been running as hard as he should be, but now this season he has been.
He lifts this one to deep right center. Chasing it is the center fielder, and Bishop makes the catch.
You know, Kwan, not known for his power, and that's about as much you'll really see of him getting under the ball. He's generally a slap hitter who's more focused on just getting slap hits and kind of in between the infielders and the outfielders more than getting it out of the park. And, you know, that's not his job. His job is to get on base. If you're lucky, you get a home run. But again, it's not all about the home run swing. It's about just getting on base.
Well, that was a deep fly ball for Kwan. Definitely the farthest we've seen him hit one this summer. It'll bring up Kyle Kasser. Grounds it immediately to the first baseman Infante. He takes it to the bag himself, and that will do the third inning. We're still tied 0-0 here at Spillane. Who will strike first? Maybe we'll find out in the fourth. You're watching Wareham Gateman Baseball on WCTV.
Miller Hogan's family. Welcome. I'm here with Miller Hogan's aunt, uncle, and cousin. So welcome to Spillane Field, guys.
Thank you. Thanks. Glad to be here.
So you guys are from all over, St. Louis, Chicago, Nashville. So what made you guys decide to come here today?
We're here to see Miller, but we've been coming to the Cape for 40 years. So dream come true to see one of our relatives out on the field.
So what is it like, you know, you get to see him start, so what is it like to see this happen?
Unbelievable. I think my father's probably moved to tears, as is my husband. We're big St. Louis Cardinals fans, woohoo!
So what has it been like getting to support him and see him grow throughout his entire career?
It's been really amazing to watch him come into his own. He's really an intense, focused player, and this, he is living the dream. He's loving this. It's a great experience.
So you guys are from St. Louis where he plays, so how often did you get to see him get to play at school?
We've been really blessed because he's going to St. Louis University and he lives in Kansas City, so he's literally within 15 minutes of the majority of his family. So we get down there as many weekends as we can to watch all the in-town games, and his grandparents don't miss a thing.
So how embarrassed do you think he is that you guys are cheering for him and you know, his interview?
He's mortified, mortified.
Well, thank you guys for your time. It's been great getting to know you guys, and I hope you enjoy.
Say one more thing. Hey, Boston, his name's Miller, not Mila.
I have not said that. I do not have a Boston accent, so.
It's Mila.
It was great to meet you guys, and happy birthday to Miller's cousin. And enjoy the rest of your time here.
Thanks so much.
Back to you guys.
Thank you very much, Claudia. The Hogan family seems like certainly a lot of fun.
Yeah, I might travel out there and just start watching the rest of the game with them. They're screaming out there, and this is some, you know, Spillane Field is always nice. It's one of the bigger ballparks here, and obviously you got a lot of fans here, but that might be some of the most excited group of just contained fans we've seen this season. You know, we've had a few families come here, but no one literally just coming out and just yelling. You know, the cousin, nephew, he's on the mound. Don't want to distract him and all. Obviously, you want him to have a good start, but he's, you know, he's got to deal with now the family watching him. A little more pressure.
Hogan gives up a fly ball deep to right. Pompey makes the catch at the wall. What a great play by Tristan Pompey. His first starting right this summer, and he goes crashing straight into the fence. What a play.
You know, I mentioned earlier that there's only the warning track in right field. I think that helped Tristan Pompey right there to know where the wall was. He took a couple slower steps to get his momentum up. Beautiful catch. Was good. If he didn't get it, was going to hit probably the top of the wall. Might not have gotten over, but a phenomenal play by Tristan Pompey. And I'll tell you who appreciates that more than anyone, Miller Hogan's family.
Oh, yeah. I mean, I was about to say, Miller Hogan's been putting on a show. I thought that one might have been a home run. It could have been just as easily as Pompey made that play. First pitch, and it's ruled that the batter, Michael Curry, did not go around. Ball one.
Yeah, and definitely if you're Miller Hogan, this is obviously the important inning, probably more important than any of them, because the fifth inning of work, you know, you're kind of winding down. The fourth inning is really the inning where you need to shut things down, because the Gatemen haven't scored yet, and you don't know how many runs they could put on the board. They've struggled with hitting the past couple days here in Spillane. So any type of pitching support that you can get for the runners. And, of course, being able to field great plays does help you at the batter's box as well. Tristan Pompey, first day in the field, a little different for him. Maybe that will boost his confidence not only in right field but at the plate.
Can't see it on your screen right now, but the entire outfield is in a very bright sun now. Most of the infield is in the shade. But Tristan Pompey, he just made that catch at a time where the sky was not so bright. Right. Now it's darkened up a little bit. Some big clouds here today at Spillane. We were expecting rain, but it never came. And here's another deep fly ball lifted to left. It'll go out of play, though. So Miller Hogan giving up two long fly balls in this inning, but none have come to hurt him so far.
That being said, when you have the opponent making good contact, does get into your psyche a little bit and makes you think, all right, well, this pitch isn't working as well. Time to go to a different pitch. And sometimes if all of a sudden they're making contact on every pitch, now you're wondering, where do I go now? And sometimes it's taking a little speed off your fastball or even just trying to just throw everything at them.
The 2-2 grounded foul. Curry, in the 2016 summer between his freshman and sophomore years, played for the Strasburg Express of the Valley Collegiate Baseball League, hit 302 in 30 games, had two home runs, 12 RBIs. You know, before they come to the Cape League, so many players have such different collegiate baseball experiences. Curry lifts this one into center. Stephen Kwan's going to watch it drop. He picks it up right before he gets to the wall. Throws it in, Kasser chases it. It's going to be a stand-up double for Michael Curry.
The deep fences here in Spillane not helping the game in on that play. You know, when the fences are so deep, your outfielder is so spread apart now that you don't, if maybe it's a smaller field like we've seen in Chatham, for example, where it's a smaller outfield, you know, you have less ground to cover and maybe your outfielder can get there. Maybe that could have been a play at the wall, but you have a better chance of getting there, whereas now you're so spread apart and that's going to cost you big time. When you have to deal with every little thing and every little step could be another base.
Yeah, that one almost got all the way to the wall. If that's a faster runner, I know it's left center field, but that could be a triple for some guys just because of how deep the walls are here.
One of those guys being the guy that made the play on that ball, Stephen Kwan.
Oh, for sure. So now there's a runner in scoring position, and Curry is 2-for-2, by the way, today off of Miller Hogan. Batter now, Kyle Datras, who grounded out to the first baseman Anchia back in the first inning. Hunter Bishop, who struck out looking against Hogan, is on deck. There is that curveball for Miller Hogan. It's got that like 11-5 action. And it really just dropped down for a strike right there.
And he's going to need to utilize that a little more. He's been focusing more with his fastball today. But when you know you get in trouble, and that curveball, very effective, especially on getting grounders, which is always important because then it doesn't allow the runner at second to move forward, or you can get the runner at second caught at third base.
So time's called. Just as a reminder, if you're trying to follow this game on Point Streak tonight, there is no current statistics being put into the Cape Cod Baseball League website. Little bit of trouble at Spillane tonight with the official score, so the live broadcast is the only way to keep up with the game tonight. Hogan working out of the stretch. Former Kansas City star, All-Metro Player of the Year back in high school at Blue Valley Southwest. He deals and gets a ground ball that just goes foul.
Possibly lucky for the Gateman right there. That ball brought Mets all the way to the edge of the diamond and could have been trouble trying to make that play. Most K players, you usually have your power players that are a little slower and your speedsters that don't have as much power. Well, at the Cape, we've seen this everywhere, so that everyone can do everything, and everyone's going to run out everything very hard. So it's tough. If a play's at the edge of the diamond, you have to immediately throw it unless you're going to be stuck with the runners then on first and second with only one out.
Miller Hogan, 6'2", 200 pounds, deals and just misses. McIver tried to frame that one, but Sparky Burns says, no, sir.
Yeah, you could see just below the knees right there, just out of the strike zone. Pitch that sometimes you see a lot of players, they like to hit also because it's a little bit of a golf swing that you have right there when it's just at the knees.
So Hogan will take the sign from his catcher McIver. At second, it's Michael Curry, who just had a stand-up double to left center. And Miller Hogan will turn and look at him now. Miller Hogan breathes, kicks, fires. 2-2, fouled off the foot of Kyle Datras. You know, we talk about all sorts of guys having different collegiate baseball experience coming into this summer in the Cape Cod League, because usually you'll get guys who just finished their sophomore year and will be juniors in the fall. That's for the most part what it is. The Gatemen have a couple of younger guys and not many older guys, but last year Datras spent his summer with the Baltimore Redbirds of the Ripken League. We've seen guys, they come from the Valley League, the Ripken League, the Northwoods League, the Alaska League, Hamptons League. So it's interesting that they all sort of meet up here in Cape Cod after their after their sophomore seasons. But after their freshman years, even if you come from big schools, you could really end up almost anywhere.
Yeah, and that sometimes is also a good thing because it allows you to build confidence. Not to say that you're playing against lesser players, but if you want to say that the talent maybe is a little bit worse, you're playing against, you're able to build your confidence, make sure your swing can get contact if you're a batter, make sure your pitches are really hitting their target, and you don't have to be necessarily as precise. But here, if you're off by just a couple inches on a pitch or on a swing, that could be it.
Ball in the dirt is blocked by McIver. He'll throw on the third. And the throw, it will beat the runner, Curry. What a great defensive play by Willie McIver. That is not the first time we've seen him do that.
He and Jake Angia have phenomenal arms behind the plate. We haven't seen it as much from Blake Sable because we haven't seen Blake Sable as much behind the plate. But Willie McIver has such a great arm, and he's also able to utilize that not only behind the plate, but at third base. We've seen a few times where he's able to just take a little bit more time at third base and then make a phenomenal throw over to first to get outs.
The situation changes now. Miller Hogan's one pitch away from ending this inning. And he'll have to do it again. The 3-2. There was a runner in second with one out. Suddenly, nobody on and two outs. Little base-running blunder there for Michael Curry, but a better play by Willie McIver. He blocks the ball to the opposite side of third base and still puts a great throw, and Robbie Metz puts down a great tag.
A few days ago, the coaches were working with the catchers on blocking drills and just being able to get very quickly from left to right, and you saw the importance of it right there.
Hogan will walk the batter, Datras, and this inning continues.
A little bit different than what we've seen normally, besides the past few games, from game and pitchers is really the walks. They haven't had a lot of those, and the last couple games, maybe it's a little, getting fatigued. It's a long season, especially coming off a very long time playing in college and everything. Now the control a little bit off. Miller Hogan's two starts before this had no walks. Now he has two.
Pitching in front of his family tonight, that, as Claudia found out, they came from all over to be here in Wareham, Massachusetts. to watch the former Prep Baseball Report Candace High School Pitcher of the Year. Hogan graduated high school in 2015. He hails from Overland Park, Kansas.
You know, playing in front of family is just a whole different experience and a whole different amount of pressure, because you really, you know, there's something about impressing the scouts. There's something about impressing all the fans and making everyone happy. But you really want to impress your family, because, you know, they're the ones that love you the most, and you really want to show them, hey, I can do it. I can be just as good as everyone else out here. You know, I'm not saying I've done it in intense sports, but it's definitely important.
Runner goes, and the throw gets away from Kyle Kasser at short.
Throw had a quick hop right before the second base bag, and Kasser wasn't able to get under it, and that led to the runner getting to second. Now, Miller Hogan, a little bit of a similar situation where ahead in the count, but a runner on second.
So MacIver, 1-for-2 on gunning down stealing runners in this inning and in this game. Datras and Kasser having a conversation behind second base. And Miller Hogan just misses the put-away pitch. That fastball on the outside corner.
You know, you have pitches to work with right here. Obviously, you have three balls till you walk them, so you want to make sure you get the right pitch.
Miller Hogan did catch Datras stranding a little too far from second. Just didn't think he wanted to make the throw. Instead, he'll try to get the third out of this inning at the plate. Curveball fouled off.
Dangerous thing about doing that, though, is, you know, there's always the possibility of getting called for a balk, and even when you don't realize it, you might have gotten set in the position, ready to pitch, and you're ready to make a move. All of a sudden, it's too late. Umpire brings the runner to third, and now you have an even bigger problem.
Well, at second base, it might be the hardest place to pick somebody off. It's also the hardest place to get a balk. Just because you can almost do anything once you, as long as you lift that front foot up and don't move it towards the plate, You can balance yourself in the air for as long as you'd like before you go over to second. You can sort of twist around any way you want to. That happened to the Gateman the other night. And Willie MacIver, strike three, inning over. Top of the fourth ends with a swinging strikeout and a loud applause from the Hogan family. We'll go to the bottom of the fourth. Can Miller Hogan get some run support? You're watching Wareham Gateman Baseball on WCTV. Willie MacIver, the three hitter, will lead off the inning for the Wareham Gateman. We're in the bottom of the fourth. Willie MacIver shows bunt. He gets it down perfectly down the third base line. And Montier has no throw over to first. Not often you see your three hitter or your starting catcher get a bunt base hit, but Willie McIver, he's been pulling out all the stops with his legs this summer.
Yeah, I don't think we can, you know, we keep being so impressed, but we have to take that catcher phrase off because he's just been so fast all season long. Just not even surprised anymore. As we go around the Cape really quickly, Falmouth and Hyannis, they were supposed to play at 6 o'clock today, but because of the rain earlier, unable to get the field ready, so now their game pushed down to the...
Tisk-tisk, Hyannis. To the second time they've done this season.
So their game pushed to the 17th, forcing the Wareham Gateman.
John Topa just took a shot to the left shoulder or near the face area, but he looks perfectly fine. I think he'll be glad to have to push Willie McIver into scoring position. He was showing bunt there, maybe trying to sacrifice, but instead he's on. Wow, dangerous situation there. Moultier looks like he's struggling with his control.
Yeah, and you know, in that situation, obviously, not good to get hit, but if you're Topa, technically you got the job done, you're on base, and you move the runner up, over, and you're giving it now to one of your best hitter, pure hitters.
Best pure hitter is going to be the third Gateman of this inning to show bunts. Let's see if Pompey will continue to try to sacrifice bunt here. If so, if where he's going to put the bunt depends how the Brewster infield chooses to play this. Both first and third in, and it's going to be a ground ball straight to the second baseman who bobbles it. That was a tailor-made double play ball, but the second baseman Dunn could only get the out at first. So Pompey, he does get the job done in a way.
Yeah, you know, interesting moves, but hey, if you get the runner over, it's important. So I was mentioning that Falmouth Hyannis game. The reason that's important for Gateman fans is this. That game now being played on the 17th. Gateman were supposed to play Hyannis on the 17th. That game now moved over to the 18th, so the Gateman now having an off day next Monday instead of next Tuesday. Other games going around the Cape. The Chatham Anglers at the Kootuat Kettleers. Chatham, we saw them last night, now up 9-3 over Kootuat, so they're keeping the scoring going after last night. Orleans up 6-5 at YD in the top of the 8th. And the other game going on is Harwich, who's struggled this season so far in the East, but they have a 2-0 lead over the Bourne Braves in the bottom of the 4th.
Well, those are all scores that the Gatemen should like right now. Bourne and Kootuat both losing. Hyannis not playing tonight, but the Gatemen, they held a one-point advantage. Line shot, it's going to skip on the ground. Willie McIver breaks for home. He scores the game's first run. As always, great awareness on the base paths by Willie McIver. The Six Flags music plays here at Spillane Field, and the Gateman lead.
What an odd fourth inning. What an odd turn of events right there, where really no play went the way that the Gateman wanted it to go. You don't want to have a ground out that gets your runner at first out. And generally when that happens, you immediately see a turnaround throw by the first baseman to home plate. And in that case, there wasn't any. And William McIver easily able to get home. John Topa left on second. But one run right now is all the Gateman needs to take a lead.
Well, that was the smart decision by Topa, seeing a line drive straight to the shortstop. He decides to return to second. So that was Jake Anchia's RBI groundout. The Gatemen, they've had, I think most of their RBIs driven in have been off of groundouts. The first one yesterday against Chatham, an RBI groundout by Stephen Kwan that scored Tristan Pompey. And the only run in the YD game came in the seventh inning, Robbie Metz's RBI groundout that scored Willie McIver. So McIver in the past three games has scored on two RBI groundouts.
And one of them, I have to mention, is in the ninth inning of that game against YD, where it looked like he almost got a hit. He got a hit, technically, but then got an error on that. It was got an error to move him over to second, and was a very, very weird game for the Gateman, who almost didn't have a hit the entire first nine innings, and yet we're going to go into extras.
So there might be two outs in the inning, but it's far from over for Moultier, the Brewster pitcher. Right now on second, it's John Topa. At the plate, Luke Bonfield, who swings strike three. Throw will be made down to first, and that'll do it. But not before the Gatemen get a run, courtesy of Jake Anchia's RBI ground out to score Willie McIver. It's 1-0 Gatemen, but can they hold on? Miller Hogan will be out for the fifth. You're watching Wareham Gateman Baseball on WCTV. The Gateman, they have a run. Willie McIver scored it in the bottom of the fourth. And Miller Hogan, he's going to try to protect the lead here. Hogan has given up a hit in every inning. So one in the 1-1-1-1 is the hit scoreline on the board for the Brewster Whitecaps. So four total through four innings. The Gateman, they just had their second hit of the game back in the fourth inning. So the Gateman lead 1-0, but they're getting doubled up on the hit scoreboard by the Brewster Whitecaps, and they will lead this inning off with Marty Costas.
You know, not all about just getting hits. In the end, you know, if your pitching is strong, your fielding is strong, then if you just get enough hits to get the lead, then just rely on the rest of your pitching to take care of the rest of it.
Costas only stands 5'9". He just finished his sophomore year with the Maryland Terrapins. Was drafted in this most recent draft in 2017 in the 25th round by the Houston Astros. So he is 21 years old, despite only being a junior next season. Takes the second ball of this at-bat.
Not sure how much longer Miller Hogan's going to go. He had 61 pitches coming into this inning. Noah Zavalas warming up in the bullpen, as well as Tanner Dodson getting a couple throws in. And Noah Zavalas and Tanner Dodson, both players that are able to go a little bit long in relief outings.
Swing and a miss for strike two from Costas. This is the 7-8-9 part of the order for Brewster, but is dangerous. Julian Infante has the only hit between the three of them, and he was gunned down at second base by John Topa back in the second. So the 2-2 from Hogan misses. And this at-bat will continue. We've seen Miller Hogan have a couple full counts through this game so far. He has two walks, which is uncharacteristic of him.
You know, you have to wonder if maybe you mentioned he had so many starts at college, if the arm fatigue's starting to get in for Miller Hogan.
Swing and a miss, strike three. Miller Hogan's fourth strikeout of the evening here in the fifth inning.
Miller Hogan just has a really good breaking ball that he's able to use in that scenario where you could see he wasn't necessarily worried. If he threw a ball and the runner doesn't go for it, he has a runner on first, and he's been able to get out of the jam every single time in this game. So he was more focused on, hey, if I can get the runner to chase, get a quick out, and if not, let me take care of it. I can get rid of that runner in a quick second.
Julian Infante, an American citizen from Miami, Florida, both his parents are Cuban-born. He hits a ground ball foul. His mother left the Cuban Castro regime at 7 years old. That was in 1973. Infante's father left the country at 4 years old in 1961. So a great story in South Florida, where so many Cuban immigrants fled the Castro regime of Cuba. Infante's parents, both in that category. He swings and misses. Big cut on strike two.
Another thing about South Florida right now that's notable is in Miami, the All-Star game is tonight. A couple former Gatemen selected as All-Stars. One of them not going to play, Dallas Keuchel. But then George Springer's had a phenomenal, can't say phenomenal enough, year for the Astros, who have been great as a whole. But George Springer has been one of the best of the best.
So both Gateman All-Stars happen to play for the Houston Astros. That's actually very cool.
Yeah, very convenient for, you know, if you're a Wareham fan, you want to go watch a game for the where you want to see, hey, who are my best Gateman alumni? Well, there you go right there. And I happened to see Dallas Keuchel earlier in the season. I was with my uncle, and, you know, he's just watching Dallas Keuchel. And he goes, this guy isn't that good. How is he getting players out? Well, sometimes, and you've seen this, especially here in the Cape, is pitchers don't necessarily need to have the most blazing stuff to get you out. They don't need the best curveball. You know, you've seen Clayton Kershaw. You know, he has that great curveball that just sinks him wherever much he wants it to. You've seen pitchers like Noah Syndergaard who have that 100-mile-an-hour fastball. Well, sometimes, just like that, it's about positioning the ball perfectly so that you put it where you want, locate it perfectly, and that's how you get outs.
Miller Hogan nails his spot in Willie McIver's glove and blows a fastball by Infante for strike three, so two away here in the top of the fifth. Hogan's pitch count has not reached 70 yet, but he's close.
And you have to wonder again, they had the two extra inning games, and yesterday they pitched four pitchers. Jordan Britton had to throw a few more pitcher, few more pitches than the other pitchers, gotten a little bit of a jam. You have to wonder again, though, if they're trying to save a little bit more bullpen and just get him through five no matter what.
So speaking of all-stars, here's one for the Brewster Whitecaps, Nick Dunn, who was in Brewster for the 2016 summer, was in the East Division all-star selection through 42 games, hit 311, one home run, 25 RBIs, and was a Gateman killer. In three of his four games against the Gateman last summer, he had two hits or more. Jaron Duran takes a ground ball and retires Dunn. That will be the third out of the inning. The Gateman, they still hold on to the 1-0 lead, looking to add more in the fifth. You're watching Wareham Gateman Baseball on WCTV. Miller Hogan goes 1-2-3 in the top of the fifth, and that's probably going to be his night. Five innings, four hits, no earned runs, just a typical Miller Hogan performance.
Not as pretty as his last couple, but it doesn't matter. If there's zero on the scoreboard over there, then you've done your job right.
Jaron Duran, he'll lead off the bottom of the fifth for the Gateman. In the bottom of the order, we'll go 8-9-1 with Duran, Metz, and Kwan to lead off this inning. The Gateman, they just struck in the bottom of the fourth. Willie McIver had a leadoff bunt single, was able to come around and score thanks to Jake Anchia. Duran lifts this one to left, chasing it and making the catch in fair play is Marty Costas. One away.
Yeah, Jaron Duran showing off a little bit of power there in batting practice, able to hit one just over the right field wall. Now, Jaron Duran, not really known for his power nearly as much as it is about his speed and able to get to first base, and then, like every other Gateman player, just keep moving along the bases.
So here's Robbie Metz. Ground ball. Metz hustling towards first. He can't beat the play from the shortstop Graffanino, and that will be the second out of the inning.
Tough for Mets really on that one. You know, sometimes these soft grounders, you're able to get a little bounce on the Spillane Field grass that's been a little wacky this year, especially the gravel has been really wacky. But on that one, straight to the fielder and easy play, and Mets retired, and almost quick inning for the Gateman.
Graffanino at short, he wears six. He's playing the number six position, the shortstop tonight. He'll lead off the top of the sixth when it comes for the Brewster Whitecaps. But Stephen Kwan hoping to extend the bottom of the fifth right now. 0 for 2 tonight with a strikeout looking to lead off this game in the bottom of the first inning. And it looks like Tanner Dodson is making his way out of the bullpen. Walking over to the bench.
You know, Tanner Dodson is one guy that you could say, oh, well, maybe he's coming in to pinch hit. In this case, I don't think so. They might want to get rid of the DH spot, even though Luke Bonfield has been impressive as of late. You might just want to throw Tanner Dodson in, even though he is pitching, because he has that good a bat.
Kwan takes a low pitch and lifts it high in the air for the third out of the inning. So we'll go to the top of the sixth. The Gatemen still have a 1-0 lead. We'll probably see a new pitcher. You're watching Wareham Gateman Baseball on WCTV. Well, the pitching change has been made. Miller Hogan in his five innings threw 74 pitches, 47 of them were strikes. I'm sorry, 73 pitches, 47 strikes. So really great outing for Miller Hogan. Five strikeouts through five innings. And that zero on the scoreboard, that's really all the Gatemen care about. And Tanner Dodson, whose job it is now to keep it that way.
Tanner Dodson, if this is typical to a Miller Hogan start, will come in relief and pitch three innings. This has been the system for the Gatemen. First, it was Hogan and Dodson combining for an eight-out shutout at Kituit. That, obviously, game ended early because of darkness and because Gatemen were just dominating. No need to continue it.
Kasser makes a strong throw at short to retire the speedy Graffinino.
And then again, it was a nine-inning game, but Hogan pitched five scoreless innings. Dodson struggled a little bit, gave up a couple runs, but it didn't matter. The Gatemen already had a large lead and were able to win again with that combination.
Well, it's certainly been a good piece of pitching for them. You know, they, like you said before in the broadcast, Matt, the Gatemen, they do provide Miller Hogan and Tanner Dodson a lot of run support. Usually, tonight, only one run, so that hasn't been the case. I mean, interestingly enough, the Gatemen, they have the third worst record in the league, good for fourth place, and currently a playoff position in the West Division. But they are second in the league in run differential.
You know, and we've talked about this a few times, where it's just the running comes in bunches, which is nice, but not really.
Another ground ball to Kasser, fields it at his belt. And this time, he beats the runner by a long shot, two away.
This is probably the most important thing for the game. It is almost, if, you know, not to say you want the offense to not score, but if the offense can come out, not score, and they win a 1-0 game. They've only won one one-run game this year, and that was the home opener against Falmouth where they walked off. That involved three runs in the ninth inning.
And
a couple of errors. And some wacky bounces from this wacky infield, this Spillane Field. So for the Gatemen, you need to be able to win without having to score 10 runs or without your pitching just throwing a complete performance. You need some sort of middle ground. These 3-2 wins, these 4-2 wins, they need to come more often because you can't expect your team to score 10 runs every game, but you can't also expect your pitching to throw shutouts.
A nice middle ground is what we're hoping for.
Absolutely. You know, the Gatemen really haven't had a lot of those games where it's been middle ground. And when it has, they've been on the wrong side of it. They had a chance to have a little bit of a not a, really a middle ground, but it was 8-5 in Falmouth, which is still a three-run game, still a safe situation, and they weren't able to get it. You know, it took until last week for the game to get their first save of the season. That's not something you want to see.
Ball outside on 0-2. Dodson still ahead in the count. You know, he could go 1-2-3 here, but he's facing a very dangerous hitter, the Northeastern Conference Player of the Year, the ECAC Player of the Year, in Mickey Gasper. Hit .342 this junior season for Bryant, but also has an impressive display of power. 7 home runs, 53 RBIs. That ops number, the combination of both getting yourself on base and slugging for extra base hits, .998. So just 2 points shy of 1,000. He went over 1,000 his sophomore year, .1046. Fly ball foul.
You know, right now you're looking for Dodson to just keep pounding his fastball that can get up to 95 miles an hour, and we've seen why he has that power. It's why he's also one of the most important outfield arms that the Gatemen have.
Gasper holds up on a really good-looking curveball down in the zone from Dodson. Gasper with that 5-10 strike zone works himself a walk. So Dodson, he was ahead 0-2, ends up giving away his first walk of this contest.
Well, it's starting to become a little bit concerning if you're Jim Lawler. The amount of walks that the Gatemen have given up the past few days. They came in starting Saturday. They were in the lead in team pitching in walks allowed. Now they're not. Orleans has taken that from them. And, you know, you need to start looking at this team. They've had since, you know, they were beating Orleans a couple days ago, 50-52 in walks allowed. Now, since then, Orleans has given up 3 walks. They're at 55. And Wareham has had 8 walks in the last 3 days.
Oh, wow.
And that doesn't, the last 2 days, not including today. So that's not a good sign.
61 now.
Yeah. Not a good sign for Jim Lawler and the pitching staff that really has been painting the strike zone so effectively.
Ground ball to Kasser at short. He'll throw it from the outfield grass. Picked. It won't be picked out of the dirt by Anshia. He bobbled it just a bit. Had to come off the base in the process. Tough play for Kyle Kasser, who he had to let that one travel all the way to the tip of the grass before throwing it.
We saw this a couple days ago, too, where the he's just taken back and he has to, instead of running onto the ball, which is what every infielder likes to do so you can get your momentum behind the throw, he has to take a step back and let the ball come to him. That allows, one, the runner to gain extra speed and be able to get to the bag, but two, you're also dealing with the problem that you can't get as much behind the throw. And with that combination, having to make an accurate throw still at the same time, too tough. And of course, Jake Anshia is not a normal first baseman. A little tough for him in that situation.
That'll be ruled a single. Definitely a tough play for Kasser. Runners on second and first now for Tanner Dodson. Got the first 2 outs of this inning fairly easily. Ground balls to Kyle Kasser. Now this is a much different situation. By the way, Michael Curry, who stands on first now, he's 3-for-3 today with a double. And Datras, he walked his last time up in the fourth and stole a base. Runner on second is Gasper. On first, it's Curry. This one runs dangerously inside.
You know, again, if you're Tanner Dodson, all you need is a grounder. Obviously, that last one was a grounder, but I wouldn't say more fieldable, but just an easier grounder for your guys and get out of this inning. And really, no matter what, you're giving up walks, you're giving up hits. As long as there's a 0 on the scoreboard, you're doing your job right.
That ball might have been in McIver's glove by the time that Datras decided to swing, missing on that inside pitch. And Dodson now 1 strike away from ending this little jam.
You know, this is where Dodson can use his full repertoire. He has the great curveball, but he also, his fastball has probably been his most effective pitch since getting to Wareham, and it's so fast that it's hard for batters to catch up to it.
What he does on 2-2 is strike out the batter. Dodson works himself a 2-out jam, but gets out of it just as easily, striking out Kyle Datras. 2 runners left on base, and Wareham's lead is still 1-0. You're watching Wareham Gateman Baseball on Wareham Community Television. So we're back in the bottom of the sixth inning. Brewster almost found a way to strike the scoreboard in the top of this frame. However, Tanner Dodson was a little more clutch. Here in the sixth, Joe Mulletier is back on the mound for Brewster. He'll face Kyle Kasser, who's 0-for-2 with two groundouts to the right side against him today.
You know, I mentioned last half inning how, you know, you want to start winning these close games. However, if you are the Gateman offense, obviously right now it's pivotal points is to start breaking out. You have the middle, you have the top of your lineup there for a reason. Getting to the middle of your lineup where you have some power, get some runners on, and possibly blow this game wide open.
Kasser's 0-for-2, but the next two hitters, McIver and Topa, have not been retired today, each 1-for-1. McIver walked in the first, and Topa was hit by a pitch in the fourth. McIver is the only man who scored in this game. Ground ball up the middle. It's going to be a play for the second baseman. And Dunn retires Kasser.
You know, it's been a lot this game and the last couple games where the Gateman, before they can get anything rolling, there already is one out on the board. And it's hard to, you know, start wanting to do things and start getting runners over when you already have a one out there. You can't risk the sacrifice as much, because if you sacrifice, then it's two outs, and the next out is already, you're done with the inning. You need to be able to get runners on early in the inning. The leadoff man has to get on eventually for the Gateman, unless more problems will start.
Here's McIver. First pitch he sees, he takes low and away. Good little changeup there from Mulletier. We've seen him all over his repertoire today, running two-seam fastballs down low in the zone, getting plenty of ground ball outs, but plenty of strikeouts as well. 1, 2, 3, 4. He's had a good day for the Whitecaps, who have lost a bunch of starting pitching as of recently. Mulletier from Monmouth, he's going to be one of the holes they try to plug. Connor Higgins was probably the best player on this Brewster team. Has since left, wanted to shut down his arm for the summer.
You know, these arms are so precious, and any little thing, you know, any little tweak could be the end of a career almost at this stage, so gotta be careful with your arm.
McIver takes ball too high up near his eyes.
You know, I just mentioned how important it is to get that first batter on. Well, the game in as a whole are coming to the today, batting 272 for the entire game, but their leadoff hitters are only batting 242. And that is so crucial to be able to get that leadoff man on. And, you know, you have Stephen Kwan is leading off the entire game and is being able to do that generally. He's had a little trouble today. But you need to be able to get that leadoff hitter on, unless you're going to be running into issues where, you know, you're running out of outs quickly.
So McIver battling here in this full count situation. He's already walked once in this game. The dangerous John Topa and then Tristan Pompey are on deck. One out. Thanks for watching Wareham Community Television tonight for Gateman Baseball. As McIver works a walk.
You know, one of the nice things you hear is, you know, you hear a nice walk, but, you know, one of the most important things to hear from any batter is good eye. And right now, that's what Willie McIver has been able to show off the past few days, is not all about getting the hits. Just get on. Have a good eye. Don't, you know, avoid getting hit. Obviously, John Tobit got hit earlier, but, you know, be safe and just get on base.
8:07 p.m. here in Wareham tonight. We're just about 10 minutes from sunset. The lights, they're shining bright on Spillane Field. The batter's John Topa, a star who's certainly been shining brightly. So is Willie McIver over on first. Both of those guys hoping to be all-star selections for the West Division.
And definitely they've played like it so far, each batting over 300, and each been pivotal to every single little part of the Gateman team, especially the small ball concept. And you mentioned sunset coming in. Well, that played a factor in one of the games today. Kituit has no lights.
Yeah.
One of two teams that has no lights on the Cape, and that made the game end in eight innings. They lost to the Chatham Anglers 10-5. In the bottom of the ninth, Yarmouth Dennis looking to put any sort of comeback on the Orleans Firebirds at home, down 75. And the other game of the night is Harwich up 3-0 now on the Bourne Braves in the top of the seventh.
Topa swings and misses, strike three. That'll send the cleanup hitter down to the dugout. So Tristan Pompey will have one more opportunity for the Gateman to score. Action there in Brewster's bullpen.
You know, John Topa has, if you know, he's been getting a lot of ground ball hits, but one thing he has struggled out with is strikeouts. That was his 18th strikeout on the season.
McIver goes. The throw. Not in time. So McIver has another stolen base. He's really been adding him on this summer.
You know, for McIver, it's not all about the fact that he has some speed. It's he has that catcher's eye. You know, he's able to read when the pitcher, what the pitcher's doing, and kind of decide, all right, I should go now. Now's the right time, because the pitcher's going to be a little bit off. You know, he's going to take a little more time getting to the plate, or the catcher might be dealing with a little bit of a breaking ball instead, and that allows McIver to get over to second base so easily.
Time is called. Infield's coming in. Pompey, he's got an 0-1 count on him, but this could be a pitching change. Moutier's pitch count, definitely well in the 70s. The Yatemen have been making him work. Now there's a runner in scoring position, two outs. Willie McIver can certainly score on any hit to the outfield.
Yeah, and I mentioned, by the way, why do you look for any comeback? Well, they just got it. Game now tied at 7 in Yarmouth Dennis.
Ooh, very exciting.
All thanks to, well, top of the ninth, the tie was broken at 5 with Jimmy Herron getting a, it was 6-5, and Jimmy Herron gets a solo home run. And then just two straight singles for YD gets the runners across and potential of extras. Excuse me, no longer.
Pompey hitting on the left side against the righty Moutier.
Yeah, Alfonso Rivas able to get the run across, and the YD Red Sox walk off.
Wow.
Haven't seen a lot of walk-offs this season, but
always
fun for everyone involved, except for the losing team.
So the Birds go down. Oh, blow a lead in the ninth. Pompey takes ball three. Now he's got this hitter's count.
And now Orleans joins every other team. They are the last team to reach double-digit losses, now hitting 10 losses, but still have a one-point advantage in the East Division over the YD Red Sox, who now have 31 points to Orleans 32.
Pompey is forced a full count by taking that strike two pitch. On deck, Anchia, who has the only RBI in this contest. Moutier will try to retire Pompey. And he won't. Ground ball foul.
Yeah, that pitch was in the dirt, and obviously a ball, but good job just working the count. You know, sometimes you decide before the pitch is coming, I'm swinging no matter where it goes, and just be able to foul it off and keep, you know, find your pitch. Because obviously Pompey, if anything's left over the middle, we've seen what he can do to a ball.
The 3-2, two outs. Outside. Jake Anchia has a chance now.
Pompey has really worked on this with head coach Don Sneddon and is seeing the ball better. Been working with the curveball machine a lot, and it helps not only with curveballs but with fastballs, just seeing where balls are going to land in the catcher's mitt. And now, you know, he came in a few days ago. He had no walks in the season, and now that's his third or fourth walk, and that's a really good sign if you're a Wareham Gaiman, you know, the Wareham Gaiman batting, to see a guy who walked so much at Kentucky now bring it over to the Cape League.
Second walk of the inning for Moultier. This is his sixth inning of work, possibly having some control issues this late in the game. Jake Anchia at the dish. He lays off the first pitch. It's just called out.
You know, he is generally a relief pitcher, so pitching six innings is not something so simple. Griffin Roberts, who's a relief pitcher at Wake Forest, being converted to a starter at Wareham, and he was able to go six innings the other night, but definitely not easy for any reliever.
Moultier looks down McIver at second. Deals. There might be a play on this for Infante, the first baseman. There will not be. It sails into the stands. Strike one.
You know, you can hear the action in the Brewster bullpen. This is a situation where if you're the Whitecaps, your hitting has not been very effective. You can't afford to get another run across. You have to really hold down the fort and keep this game at a one-run game and allow your batters to have a chance to really deal with Tanner Dodson, who's going to be on the mound next inning.
Ground ball left side. It's picked up by the third baseman, who retires Anchia. Great play by Datris to make the final out of the inning. The Gatemen, they strand their fourth and fifth runners of this game, and that will keep the game at 1-0. You're watching Gatemen Baseball on WCTV. Here's Tanner Dodson back on the mound for the Gatemen, his second inning of work. Only gave up one hit in the sixth with two outs, but stranded Mickey Gasper and Michael Curry. He had to face the top of the order his first inning of work in the sixth, and now we'll deal with the six, seven, and eight batters. First up is Hunter Bishop, who's 0 for 2 today. Flies this one foul out of play.
Noah Zavala still kind of doing some light stretching out in the Wareham bullpen. Generally, he's been, you know, he started off as a one-inning guy, but he's been more of a long reliever for the Gatemen. So maybe if this is Dodson's last inning, he'll go the last two.
Here's an interesting tidbit for you. Ground ball foul. Hunter Bishop, his brother Braden, was drafted in the third round of the 2015 draft by the Mariners. He played from 2013 to 15 with the University of Washington. And now Braden Bishop is with the High A Modesto Nuts, currently a Mariners affiliate. Don Sneddon, the head coach of the Gatemen, was the manager in 2014 of the Modesto Nuts under Colorado. Fly ball by Bishop is over Quan's head. He rounds second and heads for third. Quan's throw is cut off, and in the top of the seventh, the Brewster Whitecaps, they have the tying run in scoring position.
They've been able to take advantage of that deep center field. It's not all about getting home runs, but if you can get it out there, it's going to be a double every single time. And a couple guys in the Brewster Whitecaps dugout were screaming three, but with Stephen Kwan's arm, we've seen that if you want to go three, he's going to get you out. And, you know, good idea to stay at second. Now you have no outs still, man on second, and a chance to tie this game up.
Dodson working out of the stretch once again. He'll face Marty Costas, 0 for 2 with a strikeout against Miller Hogan. Runner on second, just had a double, is Bishop. This ball runs inside, almost beams Costas, but gets out of the way. Ball one.
Dodson from the bullpen. Looks like the Brewster bullpen is ready to come up with a new pitcher. Next inning, Sam Bordner warming up. And can I mention, you know, usually you don't see the hair is very important, but he has golden blonde hair, and you have to wonder if, you know, his teammates, you know, any nicknames about that. I would love to find out, because it is really golden out there, and, you know, not something you see every day.
Syndergaard-esque,
even a little lighter than that.
All right.
But not very long.
So Costas just showed bunt. Dodson smartly stepped off to see how the defense will play it. The bunt is down, and Dodson picks it up, throws on the first, and he got him. One away.
Tight play right there for Dodson. The bunt laid pretty nicely, and Dodson's, you know, generally when he's in the outfield, it's a lot more of an overhand throw. Well, in the infield, if you throw that overhand, you might not be as accurate, so he tries to go a little bit of a softer throw, and it almost costs him, almost an infield single. But the job was done. The runner moves over to third, and now you have one out, runner on third, and you have to be really careful.
Julian Infante has a chance to tie up this game for Brewster. Runner on third is Bishop with only one out. Infield is in. They're going to try to cut this one off if there's a ground ball. This one's fouled out of play.
For Dodson, his last time out, he did struggle a little bit, gave up a couple runs. So you have to wonder if maybe, obviously, you try to ignore all that, and Dodson's been playing almost every single day as a hitter, but does that get into your head a little bit that, you know, I was in this situation a little bit before and bad things happen? We've seen a little bit of that from Brett Conine, but he's been able to be successful.
Well, so here was a trouble situation for Dodson. It still is with that runner on third, but he just helped himself out by getting himself into an 0-2 count.
And it's right now, you know, you want to be able to use the wide variety of your pitches, but the problem is if you don't feel like you have full control over one pitch and it gets away, the game's tied.
Willie McIver, an outstanding defensive catcher. The 0-2 to Infante. High fastball plucked out of the sky by McIver. That could have been a pass ball.
And right there, Dodson was looking to put everything behind that heater. And sometimes when you're putting everything behind it, you can lose a tiny bit of grip. We also mentioned that it is a little humid out here. And any bit of humidity and stickiness can change the way you grip it. Either you want to be a little bit looser to get it out, you want to be a little bit tighter. That could cost you.
That swing out of the strike zone will certainly cost Brewster. Infante goes down. The infield can return to their normal positions. And still on third base, you see him right there, number 24, Hunter Bishop.
It's going to be interesting to see how Robbie Metz plays as the third baseman. Generally, when you're on third base, you can go about just as far as the third baseman allows you. Because if you go any further and the third baseman is out from the bag, you can be caught off on a pickoff attempt. Robbie Metz looks like he's holding Hunter Bishop very close to the bag, forcing him to have to make the move very quickly at home plate.
Check swing. The ruling, Ronaldo Cochran at third, says no, the batter did not go. Nick Dunn, the nine hitter. We talked about his three multi-hit game against the Gateman in 2016. The one time that these two have played each other, Wareham and Brewster, this summer, he had another one on June 22nd.
And it was not a pretty game for the Wareham Gateman, who struggled from the get-go, and Brewster was able to put a pounding on the Gateman.
big swing and a miss on a ball that was eye level. So now Dotson one pitch away from getting out of another jam.
And this is what you need to do if you're a pitcher. You know, and one of the nice things also, I mentioned, they got completely gassed in that game against Bruce earlier in the season. Well, most of the guys that are in the field right now were not playing in that game. That's how the Cape League works with changing rosters.
Line drive to left. Topa has to let it land in front of him. It's an RBI single for the nine hitter, Nick Dunn. This ball game is tied.
And that's how quick things can change. One pitch just left a tiny bit hanging, and Nick Dunn puts it on a ride to his left field. Topa looked like he wanted to make a play on it, but realized if he did, he would have let it go behind him for extra bases. Decides to take a couple steps back and almost got over his head on a bounce, which would have led to a double for Dunn.
All right, so Tanner Dodson gives up the tying run. This game's at 1-1. Line drive, ground ball, and it's through the infield. Rounding second and heading for third is the runner, but he will smartly retreat. Great throw by Tristan Pompey would have gotten him if he had gone, but now that's two consecutive hits and three in this inning for Dodson.
First time we got to see Pompey's arm really in action. Great throw. Got over the head of Kasser, who was trying to cut it off, but the throw was meant to go to third base. No intention of getting cut off. What was interesting is Duran made that play, same exact dive a couple games ago, and was able to save a couple runs by doing it in that case. It's a very tough play to make and just gets by him.
So McIver and Dodson have a little chat. The leading run is now in scoring position. Nick Dunn stands on second. A.J. Graffanino gets his first hit in the seventh, and he's on board at first. The batter, Chandler Taylor.
Well, Dodson has the stuff to get out of this quickly, but it's not easy, especially with a home run hitter and Taylor coming in. We've mentioned how he's able to hit the ball deep. There's a reason he was in the college home run derby.
That sort of crouching stance, the lefty batter, takes called strike two, so Dodson really helping himself out now.
Yeah, you mentioned that crouching. That's really, you know, you swing from the legs. One of the reasons the home run derbies are so tough is you really lose your legs and it turns out to be your arms in the final rounds. And for Taylor, he's really able to crouch down and lunge his entire body forward and he's been able to get... We've seen that from a couple Brewster guys getting some deep hits tonight.
It was almost strike three, both as a call and on a check swing attempt, but it's going to be called ball one on Taylor. On deck, Mickey Gasper. 2-3-4, dangerous part of Brewster's order. Dodson likes to get out of this now. He puts this one in the dirt, blocked by McIver. It could have been a base for both base runners.
I mentioned those blocking drills and how important they are and how important it is to be able for any catcher to get up quickly. You're in a squatting stance all the time, and to be able to move laterally extremely fast is so crucial, and you're seeing it a couple times from William McIver tonight.
Dodson called strike three. That'll do the top of the seventh, but not before the Brewster Whitecaps tie up this game at one. Can the Gatemen now take the lead? You're watching WCTV. It's the seventh inning stretch. Bottom of the seventh inning. Hope you enjoyed your stretch. I certainly did. Clem Spillane Field, the site of tonight's ball game between the Wareham Gateman and the Brewster Whitecaps. Connor,
thing you have the new pitcher in. That's
Western Michigan Broncos had 12 his freshman year. He was seventh in the entire country in triples this spring.
Certainly has the speed. And you just mentioned triples. Anything in the outfield now, you have to worry if that could possibly mean the guy going all the way around for home.
Pick off. Runner back. So the new runner, Connor Smith, certainly capable of taking a base. That's probably why he's in this game right now. Roach out of the stretch. Breathes. Pick off. Not in time.
Time call right before the pickoff move. You know, when you're hanging out on the mound for so long, eventually the batter's going to get restless. And if you're the batter, you don't want to tense up at all. You want to make sure that you're able to free swing. So call time, get relaxed, and get back in the batter's box. Be able to get an effective hit in a very critical situation.
Roach deals. Called at the knees. The one looked a bit low, but Sparky Burns does Dalton Roach and the Gateman a little favor.
A couple of those pitches near the knees have been called either way, and it's tough to see as an umpire, and it also depends on the height of the batter. And, you know, it's a game of inches.
Kyle Datras, the batter, back in high school at Loyal Sock Township in Pennsylvania. So this pickoff throw just gets away, and thankfully, Jake Anchi able to chase it down, but this guy at the plate, Datras, an all-state selection in football, basketball, and baseball, and was the runner-up for Mr. Pennsylvania football as an all-state quarterback his senior year.
You know, having that amount of talent, the athletic ability to play multiple sports, we've seen it so much. College coaches, and especially professional coaches, saying, you know, you don't need to specialize in one sport. Be able to play multiple sports and be effective at all of them.
Swing and a miss, strike three. Dalton Roach, his second consecutive strikeout. And now he's very close from getting out of the eighth.
Datras frustrated after swinging at that one. Broke towards the plate a little early and turned to a little bit of a golf swing right there for Datras, unable to catch up to it.
A guy who struck out twice in this game already is Hunter Bishop as the American flag flies high here at Spillane. Roach, a little concerned about the runner at first, Smith. He could take off for second.
You know,
right now, you really want to be worried about the batter at the plate, Hunter Bishop, who hit a double his last time up.
Not to make a bad pun, but Hunter Bishop, you know, he looks like a little bit of a chess game right now for Dalton Roach at first base with the runner. I mean, when you're dealing with Connor Smith, who is so fast, you need to be able to keep him close.
Good pun. I respect it. Out of the stretch, Roach fires to Bishop, just misses. We haven't, at the beginning of the season, we saw just about zero Gateman with the stirrup socks, the high socks at the knees look. I think Roach rocks it well.
You know, it's definitely a preference out there, and you want to be the most comfortable as possible, and for him, that's it.
Big swing and a miss on 2-0. Looked like Bishop was trying to take the lead for Brewster right there.
Yeah, and, you know, we mentioned earlier about how the big hacks for Wareham and the problems that have caused that has caused them. Well, right now you want to be the hero, and that's a problem. You've got to be able to just make the play.
Another pickoff throw to first, and Smith is probably really getting worn out over there at first.
Just came into the game, and pants already dirtier than probably most of his Brewster Whitecaps teammates.
Definitely. And that little gray silt getting dirty here at Spillane. Pitch is called strike two. So Roach, he gave up a leadoff single and is now very, very close from sending the Gateman to the bottom of the eighth.
attacking that inside part of the plate right now for Hunter Bishop, where it would force him to pull a hit, if anything. You know, you might want to be able to trust your first baseman to just put on the tag.
Roach breaking ball called strike three. That ends the top of the eighth, and Dalton Roach keeps this Gateman lead intact. We'll go to the bottom of this late frame. You're watching Wareham Gateman Baseball on WCTV. Sam Bordner remains on the mound. His Brewster Whitecaps trail 2-1 against the Wareham Gateman. And here's a spot of the Gateman order that can do damage. It's Willie McIver, John Topa, Tristan Pompey. That's 3-4-5. If we get to the 7 spot in this order, things become very, very interesting. But how about Dalton Roach just striking out the side?
Absolutely incredible, especially after having that huge holdup at the beginning of the inning, giving up a single and then able to just come back and dominate the rest of the inning. What's interesting here, you don't see this very often, is Sam Bordner is still on the mound, but the person he's pitching to is different. Justin Kunz taking over the catching duties.
All right. So Mickey Gasper was the starting catcher. He was replaced at first base by Connor Smith, and now they have a new catcher because Smith is a shortstop. So we talked about all three catchers on this Brewster roster being Bulldogs. The third and final one we've seen in this game tonight, Kunz, just like you said, he's from Gardner-Webb. They are also the Bulldogs. The 1-2 to McIver, low.
And McIver now, really, this is an opportunity where he can use his eye a little bit. He's been able to draw walks very, you know, very effectively this season. Able to do it today too, just being able to work pitch counts very well, and as well as his counterpart behind him, John Topa.
In this situation, as McIver ropes a single into center field, great piece of hitting by Willie McIver. He has not been retired today. 2-for-2 and 2 walks.
You know, and a great hit right there, able to make solid contact. And that was, you know, what the nice thing about that was, it was solid contact, but not swinging for the fences right there. It was just getting to that spot. The sweet spot of the entire ground is really between the outfielders and the infielders, where no one can get it. And he hit that spot absolutely perfect on a target. And now you have a chance to advance him either through a sacrifice, which looks like Topa's trying to do, or just getting a hit.
McIver is picked off for the second time in 3 games. Willie McIver reaches base and is sent back to the dugout, so John Topa will no longer be bunting.
Yeah, and, you know, McIver takes a little bit of too big of a lead right there and wasn't expecting a pickoff attempt, you know, especially with Topa getting ready to bunt. You expect that the pitch is already headed down, and sometimes you get caught sleeping for half a second, and that'll do it.
The 0-0 to Topa is called for a strike. So I was about to ask you, I mean, would you rather this be a short inning and you don't have to replace Dalton Roach, the pitcher in the seven spot, or would you rather see a couple of runs come across for the Gateman and extend your lead?
I mean, if you're the Gateman right now, you have pitchers still back there that can be successful. It looks like Brett Kinnane's getting ready in the bullpen, who is one of the best closers in the country. So you really want to get a few more runs across and give yourself a little bit of insurance. It is tough in a 2-1 game. We've seen the Gateman struggle with these close games. To just give yourself a little bit of a lead is probably more important.
John Topa strikes out for the second time tonight. Now Tristan Pompey is up. So maybe Dalton Roach is going to be replaced anyway.
Yeah, I mean, and not a knock against Dalton Roach, but when you have Brett Kinnane in the bullpen there to give you a ninth inning, three outs, you know, there's not many other people in the country you want at this level than Brett Kinnane.
Now, while Roach has only been a reliever so far for the Gateman, as Pompey lifts this one into right center, coming on and making the play near his knees is the right fielder, Taylor. We'll head to the top of the ninth. Can the Gateman hold the 1-0 lead? Who will the pitcher be? All these questions. Find out the answers on WCTV. We're going into the top of the ninth, and here on Jimmy Buffett night at Spillane Field, Cheeseburger in Paradise finally plays throughout the park. Sorry I'm breaking it up for you. You can probably still hear it.
You know, they had it go, you know, they had the whole raffle for Cheeseburger in Paradise, and yet it takes till the top of the ninth to play it. You know, I was looking forward to it all game. Now, this very serious situation where got a little bit less jamming out.
I mean, while Cheeseburger in Paradise is known as one of Buffett's best songs, I'm a huge Margaritaville guy. I know 5 O'Clock Somewhere is Alan Jackson, but he makes a great feature on it. All right, enough of that. It's the top of the ninth. Brett Kinnane is here. He's a serious guy. He stares down the plate before every pitch with such intensity. The only thing more intense than his look at the plate might be the way he throws that fastball in.
Absolutely. He's able to paint the corners of the strike zone phenomenally. 6 strikeouts on the year so far for the Gateman with no walks. What's interesting for Kinnane, though, is his first outing came out here, got the first 2 outs, and then gave up 2 runs. Next outing, got the first 2 outs, and then ran into a little bit of trouble, got the third out, was able to get out scoreless. And then the outing after that, gets the first 2 outs, goes full count on the third batter, able to strike him out and get out of there. So for Kinnane, one problem we've seen from Gateman pitchers tonight is that third out, getting the third out. We're going to see how Kinnane deals with that tonight.
Kinnane's first 2 pitchers are called balls, but this is a guy who so far through the 2016 summer has walked no one and has struck out 6 through three innings. So that's two strikeouts per inning pitched for Brett Kanine. And he's really got magical stuff. 15 saves at Cal State Fullerton this spring.
And you mentioned that fastball, but it's really that breaking ball that's the most important pitch for him. His first appearance, Don Senton said afterwards when he gave up the lead, he said, you know what, Kanine threw too many fastballs. The next appearance, he started using that breaking pitch, and when you mix them together, it is so effective. And that's the ability that he has, and that's how he gets ahead on counts, and then he can close you out with a sinking pitch.
So Sparky Burns calls that one himself behind the plate. It's a swinging strike two on Marty Costas, who is 0 for 2 today in a sack bunt. On deck, Julian Infante and Nick Dunn, the 7-8-9 part of this order. Kanine, a big changeup, called for ball three.
You know, Infante is a guy that right behind in the second spot in this inning is someone to worry about because he has the raw power that on this fastball that comes so quick at you can send it right back out of the park.
3-2 fouled away. Kanine probably going to go with a fastball on 3-2 to try to retire Costas. You definitely want to locate inside the strike zone. You know, we talk about this being the 7-8-9 part of the order for Brewster right now. The only RBI today has come from Nick Dunn, who is the 9-hitter.
And you mentioned Dunn also. Last year was an all-star, so he's not afraid of this moment right here.
But first, Kanine and Costas out of the stretch. Ground ball right back up the middle. Kasser fields it, and he got him. One away.
Good ground ball. Looked like it came off the mound a little bit, which slowed down the rotation of the ball, kind of brought it closer to the ground than Kasser was expecting. He was expecting it kind of to pop into his glove. Instead, started rolling, but he was able to run up on it and make an effective play to get the first out.
Up now, Julian Infante, number 47, in teal blue. On deck, Nick Dunn, who we were just talking about. So one away for Kanine.
Yeah,
Infante from Vanderbilt.
This is where I'd love to see Kanine start working those breaking pitches. You have a home run hitter, force him to kind of reach for a pitch and maybe pop it up to your outfielders.
There's that big breaking ball. You know, the story of Kanine's 2016 summer was working on that changeup with pitching coach Jim Lawler. And what a long way it's come. You know, struggled a bit, is a reliever for Cal State Fullerton his freshman year, comes to the Cape, goes back to Fullerton, and has an amazing season for the Titans. There's that pitch again, strike two called. So pitching backwards right now is Kanine. He hasn't thrown a fastball yet to Infante.
And that's kind of what you want to see, because if you have that fastball, for a power hitter, it's the easiest pitch to hit out of the park because it's got the most velocity on it, momentum, put a little physics on it. Guess what? You put enough bat swing back, and it's faster coming out.
Kanine and Infante, two returning players to their respective teams. The 0-2 swung on, fouled off. Yeah, Infante in 2016 with Brewster hit 205, two home runs, nine RBIs in about 25 games, so didn't make... wasn't a regular for the Whitecaps exactly, but comes back for this summer with unfinished business in Brewster.
Absolutely, and you know, might not have had the best Cape League season, but was able to come back at Vanderbilt and have a phenomenal year. And that's what you know, this is still, it's a show-off league a little bit, if you want to say it that way, but it's also a development league.
0-2, Infante thought about chasing that one out of the zone and checked his swing.
Like that pitch a lot. You know, you don't want to say you have a throwaway pitch, but you don't want to give him something on 0-2 that's right down the middle. That's really your 3-0 pitch might be right down the middle. You know, you force him, hey, maybe he'll swing on it, get me out of this at-bat really simply, and with not the hardest pitch I have to throw.
Well, with Infante on 0-2 or 1-2, you probably don't want to give him anything even close to the strike zone. Infante has struck out in his past two at-bats, but is 1-for-3 today with a single. 1-2. Misses, and Kanine, this count is even now.
Joe DeMare is in the Brewster bullpen right now in case Brewster can tie or take the lead. And, you know, that's huge. Sometimes, you know, you see, you know, maybe it's like, oh, just get a bullpen session. But right now, you have a couple power hitters coming up, and you have the top of your lineup right after that if you can get a hit or someone on base. So it's very possible you could see Brewster make a comeback right here.
Kanine with the long sleeves on a human night gets... Infante to Chase. McIver down to Anchia. Second out.
You know, great pitching job there by Kanaim forcing a chase pitch right there. But like I mentioned, this is where the struggles have been, not just for Kanaim, but for all the Gateman pitchers, is that third out of the inning. You got to close it out. It's the most important out you can get. Obviously, 27 outs in the game, and this is the 27th one. If you can finish it off right here. But Kanaim has struggled a couple times with this, was able to be very effective with it in his last appearance.
That's the 12th strikeout of the game for Gateman pitchers. Miller Hogan had 5 through 5. Tanner Dodson had 3 through 2. Dalton Roach had 3 strikeouts in 1 inning. And Brett Kanaim has 1 through 2/3 of an inning. Now 1 out away from ending this. Here's Nick Dunn. Big swing on 1-0. He wanted to tie the ball game right there, but Kanaim, that fastball just has too much speed, too much life. We'll go with the 1-1. Kanaim, 24 in white, always goes out of the stretch. He breathes, kicks and deals. Lined into right field, or center. And now the tying runs on base.
You know, in a one-run game is just how quickly the tides can turn. Obviously, Kanaim always pitches out of the stretch, so it's not much of a difference with pitching motion. But you have now that you have to think in the back of your head. You have the runner on first. You can try a couple pickoff moves, but if I'm Kanaim right now, I'm guessing I'm going right after Graffinino and attacking him with my best stuff, which could be a little bit of the fastball, and also got to utilize that breaking pitch.
Two West Coast guys meet and what could be the deciding at-bat here on the Cape Cod Baseball League. Graffinino from the University of Washington. Kanaim from Cal State Fullerton University. Big moment.
And there's a couple Washington guys also on the Gateman side. It'd be interesting to see if he was able to fly it out to left field right now, where his Huskies teammate is.
You know, Willie McIver behind the plate. He's a bit of a jokester, even in the most serious of moments. But he lets this one go by him right here. And now the time runs in scoring position. I was just about to say, maybe Willie McIver's getting in the hitter's, Graffinino's, head a little bit.
You know, right now it's all business for Brett Kanaim, who now has the tying run at second base. Obviously, you know, still got to get hit to move that runner across, seeing how there's two outs. But, you know, you need to be able to throw a very good pitch right here. Something that could be, you know, you don't want to throw one right down the middle, obviously, but this might be the time, if any, to just throw your hardest fastball right down the middle and get back into this count.
Well, that one was over the middle of the plate, but just a little too low in the dirt. It'll be ruled a wild pitch. This game could suddenly take a very different turn. Kanaim gets a ground ball foul, one strike.
I have to apologize. I said Huskies teammate. It would be Huskies if we were just going by team name. John Topa of UConn.
Right.
Excuse me about that. Ben, if it was Ben Baird in left field right now, it would be Huskies teammate.
Oh, you know what? I didn't even think of that when you said it. But the Washington teammate is behind the plate in Willie McIver. On deck, Chandler Taylor. Just as dangerous as any in Brewster's lineup or in the Cape League. Here we go with Kanaim's 2-1 in a game where his team leads 2-1. Swinging strike for number 2.
Yeah, we'll use that breaking pitch effectively right there, and you know, now you have the option. You've shown both, you know, you've shown all your pitches so far in this inning, but you've shown them all effectively. You've shown that you also get the batter to chase on that last pitch. Now you have a choice on where you want to go throughout your arsenal.
Kanaim with a 2-2. Tying run is on second base, and time is called by the batter Graffinino, making this intense at bat even more strenuous.
And that's honestly, you know, if you want to ruin the timing of the pitcher at all, it's the right move to make to give yourself the perfect at bat.
Kanaim deals. Strike 3, game over, Gateman win. 2-1. Kanaan gets his second save of the season. Stranded at second is Nick Dunn. The Gatemen break their 2-game losing streak, 3-game winless streak, and move to 11-13-1.
And this was arguably the most impressive win of the season because this is the game where every single hit mattered. Obviously, you have the man on second base right there in the ninth inning. Every single batter mattered, only winning 2-1. So not a ton of offense right there, but your offense did enough, and your pitching was great tonight. You gave up one run, but hey, that's what you can expect that from your pitching. Giving up one run is a very nice night. You can't expect to win every game 9-0, and you can't. But you also can't be losing every game by the same exact score on the flip side. This is their first one-run win since the home opener, and that was a walk-off. So to be able to secure this win and be able to hold the lead basically the entire game is so critical and so important for the game and moving forward.
Well, they do win by the score of 2-1, as you said. The offense, they struggled again today.
Absolutely, and something you don't want to see. They've only scored now 5 runs in the past 3 games. However, sometimes when that happens, your pitching needs to pick you up. In this situation, the pitching absolutely stood tall today. And only giving up one run again. That's a great day in the Cape League. You see all over the rest of the Cape, teams scoring 8 runs every single night. When you can give up one run and take the win, that's called a happy day if you're Don Sned and Jim Lawler and the rest of the team. And especially now you have to go into tomorrow back on the road. You know, it's nice to take a little one game at least in your homestand.
Tanner Dodson gives up that only run for the game, and he ends up getting the win tonight on the mound. Also happened to score the winning run in this game. I mean, just another great performance from Tanner Dodson, getting it done at the plate and on the mound. 13 strikeouts in this game for Gateman pitchers. They finally get a win. We thought they might have gone winless on this homestand, and this means a lot.
Absolutely. The first really drought for this team was very beginning of the season. 2-5 to start the season. Things looked really down. They look like they were starting to go back on the rise a little bit this past week. 3 straight winless games. You start to get worried, hey, is this, you know, maybe is this our limit? Is this our cracking point? A game like this shows you that when one side is not doing well, the other side needs to come up, and it's vice versa. You know, you saw a couple days ago in the Falmouth game where it was 9-9. Obviously, it was a tie, but the offense was able to pick up for the pitching. In this one, the pitching able to pick up for the offense, and a phenomenal win for the Gatemen, who absolutely needed it in the 24th game of the season.
What an exciting one. It comes down to the wire, but the Gatemen win by a score of 2-1 over their East Division foe tonight, the Brewster Whitecaps. For the whole WCTV crew and my color commentator and producer, Matthew Weasel Thayer, I'm Connor Federico. Thanks for watching this presentation of Wareham Gateman Baseball on WCTV. Good night.